Hi, welcome to La Jolla Presbyterian Church. My name is Ron Bowles, and I'm the Director of Worship and Arts here at the church. The church sanctuary has beautiful stained glass windows throughout. We're going to take you on a tour of those windows. But the first window we're going to show you is the rose window, which was installed in 1930. It's way up high. A few years ago, I decided to learn everything I could about these windows in our sanctuary. I like to think of this gallery of art as one of the hidden secrets here in the village of La Jolla. And the windows themselves have lots of hidden secrets as well. There's a lot of theology and Bible story built within these windows. I've given a tour for the last couple of years called Stained Glass Stories. And so this is just kind of a video version of that. The windows all have been constructed in 1957. They were installed in 1957. This sanctuary was first built in 1930, and then during a remodel where they added the transepts on, they also installed these beautiful stained glass windows. Reverend McClellan at the time was a big fan of stained glass windows and the idea of surrounding the people with the stories of Jesus Christ. The tie that I'm wearing is actually kind of, if you went into a contemporary church, this is the sort of stained glass you would see. It's beautiful, it's colorful, it brings lots of light into the church, but it's very different than these, which are based on the ancient European style of stained glass windows that you would find in the European cathedrals. Each window was made by 11 craftsmen who handled 1,200 pieces of glass an average of 13 times, and if you do the math, that's 156,000 touches in the glass, whether it was the staining of it, the drawing, painting on it, the cutting of it, the framing it with the lead itself to place it into the window, etc. And so it's a pretty amazing feat that they did in creating this. Windows were created by an artisan named Bohdan Bukmanek. He was a Ukrainian refugee and had grown up in this whole tradition. His father had been a stained glass window maker, and as we know, most stained glass appears in churches, and so as a child he grew up in the church because oftentimes he would serve as a model for his father, who would then create the glass and be telling him the Bible story that was going with it. The windows that you see behind me are typical of all of them that we're going to take a look at. They all have certain elements that are the same. They all have three medallions, we call them. The center medallion has a figure of Jesus Christ somewhere in his teaching years. The top, there's a little small medallion that has some relation to the window itself. And the bottom has something that relates again to that particular scene in the teaching that Christ was doing. So you've got those three things that are all in all the windows. Another thing you'll see is there's a lot of blue and red kind of as the background behind the center figure. That's tradition of the European stained glass windows. They were often done with ruby red and royal blue. The other thing that's similar about all the windows is the frame. The frame around the center of the window is a grapevine. And so that's a little bit of a reference to I am the vine, you are the branches, to that Bible verse. But it also, of course, being the grapes, it's a basic relation to the communion that we take on the first Sunday of each month here at La Jolla Pres. With that in mind, let's take a look at our first window.
Number one, the infant Christ. Most everything I'm sharing with you comes from a series of 10 sermons presented by Hap Brams in 1991. Each Sunday morning, he preached on a different window. His sermons were based on notes made by Bill McClellan, who was the pastor in 1957 and 58 when the windows were installed. As I stated earlier, all 10 of these windows have common elements. They are the vine frame, The leaves vary in color, not just green, but definitely it's a grapevine, as you will spy from time to time bunches of grapes. The ruby red and royal blue tapestry behind the large medallion. It's typical of traditional stained glass windows found in cathedrals in Europe. The three medallions, the large one depicting Jesus, and then two smaller medallions at the top and the bottom of the window have elements that relate to the main medallion. Our stained glass stories begin in the north transept by the children's wing with the infant Christ window and wraps around the main part of or nave of the sanctuary and ends in the south transept next to the Bram's courtyard with the reigning Christ. This large medallion in the infant Christ window features a typical nativity scene with Jesus lying in a manger and Mary and Joseph close by. You can see the manger is full of hay and Jesus is wrapped in swaddling clothes. The circular red and white thing that looks like, ironically, a lifesaver around his head is called a nimbus. Today we might call it a halo. You'll see the nimbus looks different in the other windows. Other things you see pictured in this large medallion are the radiant beams from heaven afar, connecting the birth of Christ directly to God the Father. Notice Joseph's hand positions, one lifted up, one pointing down. This hand gesture appears in several windows uniting or connecting heaven and earth. The lamb next to the manger depicts not only the stable setting, but foretells of the role Jesus will play on earth as the Lamb of God. The small medallion at the top features the angel announcing the birth of Christ. The small medallion at the bottom features three crowns, probably a reference to the three kings who came to visit the Christ child, but it could be an allusion to the Holy Trinity. Number 2, Christ and the Children. Our second window is a glimpse of Matthew 19, verse 14, where Jesus says, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." The large central medallion depicts Jesus with three children. Note the nimbus or halo around his head. This has changed since his appearance in the nativity window. His face is kindly, suntanned, showing him as an outdoor person, healthy, strong, vibrant, alert, and active. Look at the children. Jesus holds the smallest one in his left arm, closest to his heart. In his right hand is the shepherd's staff with which he protects, keeps, and rescues. It is a picture of Isaiah's prophecy. In verse 40:11, it says, "He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young." The child in his arms is looking up into his face in full attention and adoration. Jesus seems to look back at him, but also beyond, concerned for all the world's children. The two other children are a brother and a sister. The brother standing next to Jesus gestures toward him as if introducing his kneeling sister to Jesus. The small medallion above the central medallion is a descending dove, the traditional symbol of the Holy Spirit. The small symbol at the bottom of the window depicts a little lamb caught in a thicket. It represents the lost sheep and symbolizes Jesus, the Good Shepherd, who has 100 sheep with 99 in the fold, but will not rest until he finds the lost one. Window number 3, the Christ of Nature. I like to start in this window with the small medallion at the top. In it you see architect's dividers separating the green land from the blue sea. Much of the first chapter of Genesis deals with creation, light from dark, waters above from waters below, dry land from the sea, day from night, animal life from plant life, living creatures on land from living creatures of the seas. Inherent in all the creation was a lot of dividing and separation. The small medallion at the bottom shows a shock of wheat, the staff of life symbolizing God's provision and creation for our food. In the large central medallion, we catch a glimpse of Jesus in his creation. The artist said that he thought Jesus looked happiest and most at peace in this setting out of all the windows. Why? because this is His creation. Everything is in balance and responds to His love while fulfilling His purpose. Here He is surrounded by the evidences of nature mentioned in Scripture: green grass, a lily of the field, a vine, a tree bearing edible fruit. Around Him are flying in the blue seven birds in uninhibited freedom, a classic symbol of eternity. One of Jesus' hands is over His heart, showing compassion for all of creation. His other hand is stretched out to bless the created order in general, but especially a tiny fawn at His feet. Although one of the weakest animals in nature, the fawn appears snug and secure because it is within the Christ of nature's protection. Our next window is the teaching Christ. From the Scriptures, we know of only one time when our Lord taught from the bow of a fishing boat. Of all the possible scenes that could be depicted of Christ teaching, the side of a hill, in the temple, at the edge of a town, the artist chose this particular setting. Can you guess why? The scene has been memorialized here because of our sanctuary's proximity to the sea. We see Jesus standing in the boat, uniting heaven and earth by His hand gestures. The fish below the bow of the boat is a common symbol for an individual Christian. It stems from the acrostic formed by the Greek word for fish, which is ichthys. The acrostic says, Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior. It's a little reminder of our Christian confession. It also reminds us of Jesus' challenge for us to be fishers of folks. We see very clearly that the message of Jesus is depicted here to be for both women and men. Notice the faces of the couple. The man seems a little preoccupied and the woman rather downcast, perhaps burdened or troubled. By contrast, our Lord's face is full of compassion and confidence. He knows our needs and that through His teaching, men and women will discover His love and the real meaning of life. The small medallion above the central medallion is a little hard to discern, but it is meant to depict the Holy Spirit hovering over the sacred Scriptures. The small medallion below the central medallion shows the lamp and the fan shell, which are symbols of God's grace. Number 5, Christ in the home. It's one of our two short windows that are located over the side doors at the back of the sanctuary. This window is on the north side next to the AV booth. In the central medallion, we see a moment in time that is recorded in the 10th chapter of Luke, verses 38 to 42. We see the interior of a home in Bethany, a small village just a few miles from Jerusalem. In this home lived two sisters, Mary and Martha, and their brother Lazarus. It was a lovely home, symbolized by the ornate pillar, the lush indoor plant behind Mary, and the loving pet in front of her. Jesus was often a guest in this home and knew the family well. He is sharing with Mary, and her serene expression indicates that she is enjoying His teaching. However, in the background is Mary's sister Martha, holding a bowl of fruit. You can see that she's been preparing food for their friend, but her countenance reflects a little resentment that while she's been busy taking care of business, washing grapes and such, her sister has been sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to everything He is saying. From this moment came the great teaching that our Lord shared, that Mary was actually doing the right thing listening to Jesus, because He wouldn't always be there. Martha's work, while important, was less important than the opportunity to spend time in the presence of Jesus. The small medallion above depicts our heavenly home with its three turrets, symbolic of the fact that it is the dwelling place of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Another reference to the Holy Trinity would be the cross located on each turret. The small medallion at the very bottom of the window depicts the scale, such as you would see in a courtroom, symbolizing the importance that balance always plays in our lives. Window number 6, the Praying Christ, is the short window over the back doors of the south wall of the sanctuary. The central medallion depicts our Lord at a very well-known and pivotal point in His earthly life. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane the evening before His death. There is an olive tree in the scene. The stars in the dark blue sky tell us this occurs at nighttime. The thorns behind his foot and the rugged rocks ahead foreshadow the difficulties that Jesus is about to endure. Facing all the needs of humanity, he is on his knee before heaven, communicating directly with his Father. We see the radiant beams from heaven afar, as we did in the Nativity window, connecting Jesus to his Father. Notice his uplifted hands. This was the way Jews always prayed. Their hands were open, not only asking for the gift of God, but in faith, willing to receive and follow God's will. The Lord's face shows the stress of this moment as he struggles for the strength to follow through with the full sacrifice that his Father is asking of him. The small medallion below the central medallion depicts an altar with fire and smoke. This is the traditional symbol of a living commitment of faith in Christ, also symbolic of the Lamb of God about to be sacrificed. The small medallion at the top of the window is also packed with Christian symbology. It depicts a hand extended downward from the clouds with two pointing fingers. This is a traditional symbol of the hand of God. Around the hand is a circle symbolizing eternity. You can see the lower tips of a gold triangle behind the hand. The triangle is a common symbol for the Trinity. Many of the stained glass windows in the sanctuary were individual gifts that had special meaning for the donor. This window, featuring the healing Christ, is a great example. It was given by Lucy Sherrill in memory of her husband, Dr. James Sherrill. She and her husband both joined LJPC in 1925 when Dr. Sherrill became the first director of the Scripps Metabolic Clinic, later known as the Scripps Clinic and Research Foundation. He served in that capacity until his death in 1955, 3 years before these windows were installed in the sanctuary. Some of you may remember his son, James Sherrill Jr., who was also a member of our church until his recent death. The central medallion depicts Jesus in the process of healing a blind beggar. Note the contrast between these two characters. Jesus is strong, suntanned, and sensitive, seeing everything in the spiritual scene and secular scene. On the other hand, the blind man is pale, dressed in dirty rags, gripping a cane by which he has made his way in the streets to beg. Christ touches the blind man's eyes, applying mud made of dust and spittle. The blind man's anticipation is so great that he appears to be rocking back on his heels with his head tilted, searching for the sun's light. The small medallion below depicts the caduceus, the traditional symbol for the medical profession. It is a staff entwined by two snakes with wings at the top. The staff represents the one used by Asclepius, the father of medicine. The snakes, who are known for shedding their skin and moving out with new skin, symbolize the healing and renewal that comes from our medical people. The wings also represent the possibility of new life. The small medallion at the top of the window depicts the cross of Christ over the anchor. The anchor is a traditional symbol of our faith. If our faith is anchored in Jesus Christ, we have nothing to fear. Combined with the window's contents, the cross and the anchor symbolize the health and wholeness that are made possible through the healing ministry of our Savior. In our eighth window, the commissioning Christ, we see Jesus after the resurrection. Two of his favorite disciples are with him. Peter is kneeling. He has denied the Lord three times. His position is one of humility. Jesus has his arm around John. It is a gesture of comfort and encouragement. Jesus is about to commission both Peter and John to complete a great mission. Notice the face of the Lord. It is full of confidence. He looks out into the world believing in his gospel and the ability of these faithful men to fulfill the mission of spreading the good news to all the nations. The Lord's right arm is raised with two fingers pointing up. This is an ancient symbol of one who is speaking directly on behalf of God. Above the head of our Lord is the dove, the traditional symbol of the Holy Spirit. Not only is Jesus sending his people on a worldwide mission, he is sending them out with the power of the Holy Spirit, which will be the secret to their success. The small medallion above the central medallion depicts the fish, the early sign of the Christians. Written vertically beside the fish is the Greek word for fish, ichthys, the letters of which form the ancient acrostic, Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior. The connection here is that the Lord is sending out his servants to fish for all kinds of folks who, by faith, will accept him as their Savior and Lord. The small medallion at the bottom of the window shows the world with the cross of Christ above it. The Western Hemisphere is pictured on the globe, reminding us that the gospel, by the grace of God, has traveled all the way around the world to us, and that now we have the responsibility of carrying the good news of Christ to the rest of his creation. Our ninth window, the forgiving Christ, depicts one of the most dramatic moments in the New Testament after the crucifixion of Christ. Saul is on the road to Damascus with an official affidavit to take into custody followers of Christ who had fled there for safety. Just shy of the city at midday, Saul is struck by a great blinding light in a confrontation with the risen Christ. Notice how the figure of Christ looks different in this window. He is surrounded by beams of light and is smaller and paler than in the other windows. This is the artist's way of reminding us that Christ came to Saul in a vision. This is the moment when Saul the slayer lays down his sword at the feet of Jesus, is forgiven, converted, and by the grace of God is about to become known as Paul the preacher. Notice that the figure of Saul is kneeling at the feet of Christ. This is uncharacteristic for him. He has always been proud, pushy, and powerful. A little side note, two of the strongest men in the New Testament are pictured kneeling at the feet of Christ in side-by-side windows. Paul is kneeling here in the forgiving window, and Peter is kneeling in the commissioning window. Saul is clothed in green, which symbolizes the new life coming to him that very moment from Jesus. It is a scene of surprise, but this is more than a moment of surprise. This is a moment of salvation, forgiveness, and faith. Our Savior does not condemn Saul. Rather, with hands outstretched, he welcomes him, saying, "Come to me." Our Savior has no sword at his side. The weapon that will win is the Lord's love. The small medallion at the top of the window depicts the Lamb of God, pierced through by a lance that bears the banner displaying a cross. It is an ancient symbol for the suffering Savior. The small medallion at the bottom of the window shows a ship, the mast of which forms a cross, and around the ship are the Greek words oikoumene, which refers to all the people of the world. The ship represents the Christian church. Putting together our symbols, we have this truth. Salvation comes through the suffering of Jesus Christ the Savior. But the salvation is not just for Saul. It is for the entire world. And the risen Christ has commissioned his church to take the good news of this fantastic fact of forgiveness and faith to the entire world. We've now completed the north and south walls of the sanctuary. As we turn the corner into the south transept by the Hapbrams courtyard, we come to our 10th and final window, the reigning Christ. Let's start with the small medallion at the top of the window. It contains some Christian symbology we've seen before. The triangle represents the Trinity. Here it is interwoven with the circle, which we've learned represents eternity. The combination of these symbols emitting beams of golden light suggests the eternal power and glory of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The small medallion at the bottom shows a cross in red. On each side are the Greek symbols for Alpha, the beginning, and Omega, the end. Underneath the cross, connecting the two letters, is a light-colored arch. If you imagine the central stem of the cross as part of that arch, you will see a two-color M, which refers to the Greek letter for mu, which is the middle of the alphabet. Hence, that symbol in the medallion could be read as the beginning, the middle, and the end. The large medallion shows our Lord seated alone in kingly glory as ruler of all the heavens and the earth. Our worldly symbols of sovereignty surround him, but they do not touch him, as he needs none of these secular symbols to authenticate his sovereignty. The crown of authority is pictured, but not on his head. The scepter of power is not in his hand. The orb, the small globe with the cross symbolizing his rule, is not in his lap. Note that the person is far more prominent than the throne. The book he holds is facing us, not him. On its open pages appear again the Greek Alpha and Omega symbols for the beginning and the end. The book is the book of life, and it contains the details of all the significant data of each one of our lives from beginning to end. By the contents of this book, the risen Lord will ultimately evaluate each one of our lives. But it is encouraging to remember that the one who called himself the Good Shepherd and said he knew personally every one of his sheep is now the supreme sovereign who knows personally every one of his subjects. Notice the face of the reigning Christ. It is full of peace, wisdom, understanding, and love. We started this virtual tour with the Rose Window. For more information about that window and all the others, please go to our website, ljpress.org/stained glass. When the page comes up, click on the picture of the red cover and it will open all 28 pages of our full color booklet. You'll find the information about the 8 images in our beautiful Rose Window. Thank you for joining us on our La Jolla Presbyterian Church Stained Glass Stories Tour.